We are recording the session just for anybody who is unable to join so that they can reference back. Do want to acknowledge that all of the work and the conversations that we are having around water quality impact a wide range of tribes in the area. I'm personally joining today from the traditional lands of the Duwamish, Squamish, and Stillaguamish. And as we continue to have these conversations, building on the stewardship of tribes since time immemorial, and continuing to learn from the wisdom and to maintain the accountability to that stewardship is central. As a reminder for those who may be joining for the first time, this workshop series is part of an effort by University of Washington Puget Sound Institute. It really builds on the Puget Sound Partnership's Marine Water Quality Implementation Strategy. As many of you probably know, that process involves identifying technical uncertainties. And with that process for the marine water quality, there were quite a few related to not only nutrients, but modeling. And so we're digging into those uncertainties and trying to advance the conversations and our shared knowledge through this series of workshops. We're also convening a model evaluation group and doing some modeling runs and interpretation, which you'll see more about in this, but excited to see a lot of familiar faces this morning and hope to continue to see more of you. I'm going to kick things over at this point to Stefano.
Thank you. So really the driving question today for all of us is an extension of what's been going on, as Mirelle had said, in the Marine Water Quality Implementation Strategy meetings, which is to try to define the uncertainties around the application of the Salish Sea Model for understanding nutrient scenarios. And specifically here, we're focusing in on the questions and uncertainties around sediments. And so really it's when and where do sediments have an important impact on nitrogen cycling and low dissolved oxygen impacts. And so next slide, please. So I think we're going to start, first of all, with introducing David Shull. He is a professor of the College of Environment at Western Washington University, and many of you would already know of his work, and I'll let him introduce himself a little bit further. And I'm very excited to hear about particularly the monitoring work that's been going on and what's planned for his group. So thank you, David.
Hello, everybody. Am I on camera? And can you hear me?
Yes and yes.
Excellent. Welcome. About, half a century ago, Mario Pamatmat made some of the first measurements of sediment exchange, focusing on dissolved oxygen at several stations, mostly in the main basin of Puget Sound. Since that work half a century ago, slide. There have been a number of other measurements of sediment water exchange. Shively and Paulson reviewed some of this research. And if you look at this review, which is this table shows mostly measurements of nitrogen exchange. Most of the work has been done in a few shallow inlets. There have been a smattering of samples from deeper sites, but nothing large scale, not certainly enough to be able to even estimate the average effect of sediment water exchange on nutrient cycling and dissolved oxygen consumption. This is a significant gap in the understanding of how the sediments affect water quality in Puget Sound. And with that in mind, slide. We set out to try to begin to fill some of that gap. Today, I'd like to present some data from several surveys of sediment fluxes. At first, we'll talk about a large-scale survey done in the spring of 2018. 40 stations throughout Puget Sound and beyond, and a few places in the Salish Sea like Bellingham Bay and Strait of Juan de Fuca. And we measured a whole host of solute exchange, dissolved inorganic carbon, dissolved oxygen. We made high precision measurements of pH, which together with dissolved inorganic carbon allowed us to calculate the alkalinity flux. We also measured the exchange of major nutrients, dissolved inorganic nitrogen, phosphorus, and silica. And we measured a bunch of environmental variables to try to understand if we saw variation in these fluxes, what is controlling that variation. Then we'll shift to Bellingham Bay, where we did a finer scale study of sediment water exchange. We also measured profiles of solutes in the sediments to try to understand some of the mechanisms affecting that sediment water exchange. We, at one station, measured the solute exchange over the course of a year to understand at least a little bit what the seasonality is in these processes. And finally, I'll present just a little bit of data from some of my undergraduate classes. For the last 15 years, we've been, every year I've done hydrographic surveys and measured nutrients in Bellingham Bay and put together a nutrient budget. Where does the nitrogen come from, for example? And for about a decade, we've measured this nutrient budget in both fall and spring. And I'll connect some of those measurements to our work on sediment water exchange. Finally, we'll end with examining areas where we still need to do a lot of work to better understand the impact of sediment water exchange on water quality in Puget Sound. And I'll talk a little bit about the direction we're headed and how to, we're trying to get some better estimates of these processes and address some of these uncertainties. But before I begin with all of those data, thank you. Yes, you anticipated that I was shifting. I'd like to acknowledge that this work has been done in collaboration with lots of colleagues, in particular, the Department of Ecology and Marine Sediment Monitoring team allowed us to go out on their cruises to collect our samples at the same time that they were collecting data on benthic community structure and sediment properties. We collected our sediment flux data. They made this research possible, and they were a joy to work with. My former graduate student, Emma Rigby, now Santana, she got married, did the bulk of the work on this 40 station survey for her master's thesis, 40 stations with benthic fluxes, an incredible master's thesis. I've worked with a number of undergraduates, Everett Merritt, Ryan McGinnis, Spencer Johnson, understanding Bellingham Bay and some of the processes happening there. And this summer, we shifted our focus to Hood Canal in collaboration with a new faculty member at Western, Sam Kastner, along with some more undergraduates. And so this is definitely a big collaboration, and I am grateful to everybody who has assisted with this project. So with that acknowledgement, let's consider what we did and begin to think about some of the processes that we examined. One simple way to consider the exchange of nitrogen and phosphorus is to recognize that nitrogen and phosphorus arrive as either particulate organic carbon, or they can be diffused from the water column into the sediment. And there should be an arrow pointing down. I actually updated this slideshow, but it didn't get updated, but that's okay. You can imagine that there's a couple of sources of nitrogen to the sediment. Once it arrives in the sediment, it can be buried. In terms of nitrogen, it can be lost either through burial or through denitrification, which we'll talk about in a sec. And with respect to phosphorus, the same thing sort of happens. It can be buried as apatite. It can sorb onto iron oxides, and the remainder would be returned to the water column. The reason I show this sort of simplified slide is that if you measure some of these processes, like the over exchange with the overlying water, the expected supply from the sediment, you can, by mass balance, estimate some of the things that you haven't measured directly. And we'll be using sort of this mass balance approach to try to understand the rates of different processes occurring in the sediment. So, slide. The other important thing to recognize is that when organic matter with its carbon and nutrients and so on hits the sediment, a number of processes affect its degradation or mineralization. Because dissolved oxygen doesn't penetrate more than a centimeter into the sediment, any organic matter that is deeper than the top few millimeters is not going to be broken down aerobically. Instead, it's going to be broken down by anaerobic respiration. And there are a whole suite of solutes or electron acceptors, if you will, that microbes use to breathe or oxidize this organic matter when there is no oxygen. And this figure lists nitrate, manganese oxides, iron oxides, and sulfates as different oxidants that microbes use to oxidize organic matter. Now, when regardless of whether organic matter mineralization is aerobic or anaerobic, all of these processes produce carbon dioxide or dissolved inorganic carbon. And so the flux of dissolved inorganic carbon can be used as a measure of the total organic matter respiration rate. Now, the other thing that these major anaerobic processes do is produce reduced byproducts, such as sulfides and reduced iron and reduced manganese. Now, it turns out that sulfate reduction and iron reduction are some of the major anaerobic processes that typically dominate in coastal marine sediments. And if the reduced byproducts of these anaerobic processes, the hydrogen sulfide, the iron, and reduced iron and reduced manganese, are ultimately reoxidized by oxygen, then in that case, we might expect that the oxygen consumption by the sediments ought to at least approximately equal the organic matter mineralization rate, because only a fraction of the organic matter is broken down aerobically. If those reduced byproducts are ultimately reoxidized, the oxygen consumption ought to roughly equal the organic matter breakdown rate. In other words, the flux of dissolved organic carbon, which is a direct measure of organic matter breakdown, ought to roughly equal the oxygen consumption. However, if these reduced byproducts are stored, then those two fluxes would not be equal. Or if something happens and, say, buried iron sulfide is mixed to the surface where it can be reoxidized, then the oxygen consumption rate might be greater than the organic matter mineralization rate. And I bring this up because we'll see in the data that we've collected that it's very likely that oxygen consumption is decoupled from organic matter breakdown, at least at the times that we studied these processes. Oxygen consumption is a function both of aerobic respiration and the reoxidation of reduced compounds in the sediment. So, with that introduction to some of the main concepts that will come up later in the presentation, let's talk about how we measured these things. Slide. We collected sediment cores from these stations and we performed incubations ex situ. In other words, the first two slides show us collecting sediment with a HAPS core, which collects fairly undisturbed sediment samples. And we subcored those into smaller flux cores, which you see on the right. These flux cores have an optode spot. That's a little pink spot for measuring dissolved oxygen. They have magnetic stirring bars to keep the water and the overlying water fairly well mixed, and sampling ports so we can sample the change in dissolved organic carbon and nutrients over time. These sediment flux cores were incubated in the lower left in incubators kept at bottom water temperature. And generally, we didn't take any measurements when the boat was running, but when the boat was stopped and everything was quiet, then we began our measurements, because we've discovered that if there's a lot of noise around, it scares the animals, and which are involved in bioirrigation, which changes the fluxes. And so once everything was quiet, we made our measurements. The advantage of this method is that we can cover a lot of territory. A disadvantage is that you never know for sure whether the rates that you're measuring in an incubator, even if you keep the temperature the same, are exactly what's happening on the bottom. But I'll show some data later that suggests that our numbers seem to be in line with other measurements that we've made that don't require these assumptions. So slide. Let's begin with this large-scale survey that happened in spring at 40 stations throughout the Salish Sea. On the left panel, you can see the dissolved oxygen flux. This is the amount of oxygen consumed by the sediment. And then the right panel is the dissolved inorganic carbon flux. That's the amount of CO2 essentially produced by the sediments. Note on the left that the oxygen flux varies from about 5 to 25 millimole per meter squared per day, which is on average greater than the DIC flux, which varied from about 5 to 20. This suggests that oxygen consumption is not just controlled by the breakdown of organic matter, but something else is happening in the sediments to consume oxygen, because the flux of oxygen is greater than we would expect given the flux of dissolved inorganic carbon. Note also that if we look at the oxygen plot, that in the deep basins of, say, the main basin and Hood Canal, in general, oxygen consumption rates are lower. They tend to be higher in certain hot spots, which tend to be in shallow embayments. But not all shallow embayments have high rates of oxygen consumption. So for example, Bud Inlet down by Olympia, this site near Lopez Island and Bellingham Bay, they all have pretty darn high rates of oxygen consumption. But other embayments like Commencement Bay near Tacoma have relatively lower rates. And so it's perhaps not straightforward to understand what exactly is controlling these rates of oxygen consumption. The same thing goes for dissolved inorganic carbon flux. Some sites with high rates of oxygen consumption also have high rates of dissolved inorganic carbon efflux from the sediment, which you might expect. But other sites, like Bud Inlet, for example, have relatively low rates of dissolved inorganic carbon flux despite a high oxygen flux. So there's some, again, decoupling between the breakdown of organic matter measured with our DIC flux versus the oxygen consumption of the sediment. Slide. This plot shows the distribution of nitrogen fluxes. On the left panel is the ammonium flux. The darker symbols indicate a higher release or efflux of ammonium from the sediments. The lighter symbols indicate lower fluxes. The middle panel is our nitrate flux. Note that although ammonium is generally released from the sediment, nitrate is taken up by the sediment. These fluxes are negative. Note also that like oxygen and dissolved inorganic carbon, there's a significant variation from site to site in the fluxes of these solutes. The right panel indicates our estimate of denitrification, which we estimated from a mass balance. We measured the fluxes of the nutrients. We measured the dissolved inorganic carbon flux, which is a measure of organic matter breakdown. We measured the carbon to nitrogen ratio in the organic matter, and from that worked out what nitrogen flux is missing. In other words, that the difference between what we expected the nitrogen flux to be and what we measured is our estimate of denitrification. And like the other fluxes we've measured, there's a strong variability in denitrification. There are denitrification hotspots, like in Southern Hood Canal, Bellingham Bay, Lopez Island, and there are places where denitrification rates are lower. Also note that our estimate of denitrification is greater than the nitrate flux. Now, denitrification is the conversion of nitrate to nitrogen gas. There's also another process called anammox, which combines ammonium and nitrite and produces nitrogen gas. The fact that the denitrification rates are greater on average than the supply of nitrate from the water column suggests that much of the denitrification that's occurring in the sediments is something called coupled nitrification denitrification. In other words, some of the denitrification is fueled by nitrate coming from the water column, but some of it must be fueled by something else. And that would be the breakdown of organic matter, which releases ammonium, which is oxidized to nitrate, which is then denitrified. And so we can learn a lot about nitrogen cycling just by looking at these plots. But what we don't know is what is controlling this variation that we observed from site to site. However, we can look at some of the relationships between these variables and get a little more insight. And that's in the next slide. Now, you might expect that the efflux of dissolved organic carbon might be a function of how much is arriving from the water column and or how much is being broken down in the sediment, right? In which case, the amount of organic matter broken down in the sediment ought to correlate with the amount of nitrogen entering the water column. The plot on the left, where we plotted the dissolved organic flux, that's the sum of the ammonium, nitrite, and nitrate fluxes, versus the dissolved organic carbon flux, which is a measure of the breakdown of organic matter, indicates that there's no relationship whatsoever between the amount of organic matter being broken down in the sediment and the amount of nitrogen being released or taken up by the water column. In general, the dissolved organic carbon nitrogen flux is very small compared to the DIC flux. And actually, many of the stations have negative net dissolved organic nitrogen fluxes, indicating that denitrification is very important at all these sites. The dotted line in the panel to the left shows the amount of nitrogen we would expect to be released if the scenario were simple, where the organic matter breaks down, that nitrogen in the organic matter is released and then goes back to the water column. Nearly all of our sites had fluxes of dissolved organic nitrogen that were much lower than that simple expectation, again, indicating that removal processes in the sediment are inhibiting the release of nitrogen into the water column. If we look at the middle panel, it shows the phosphate flux as a function of the dissolved organic carbon flux, or the breakdown rate of organic matter. And again, there's no relationship whatsoever between phosphate and the breakdown of organic matter in the sediments. In general, the phosphate fluxes were tiny and averaged about zero. And so phosphorus hits the sediment in organic matter and basically stays there. The same way that what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, what hits the seafloor pretty much seems to stay in the seafloor. Finally, on the right, we see the plot of dissolved oxygen uptake by the sediment versus the amount of inorganic carbon released. The one-to-one line is what you'd expect if the dissolved oxygen consumption rate is a good measure of organic matter breakdown. What we see is that in general, particularly in sites with lower dissolved organic carbon fluxes, that the oxygen uptake rate is much greater than we would expect. It's above that one-to-one line, which means something other than organic matter mineralization is using up oxygen. We hypothesize, and I'll show data that supports this in a minute, that this dissolved oxygen uptake by the sediment is caused by the remineralization of these stored reduced compounds that perhaps arrived after the spring bloom. But in spring, before the spring bloom, much of the oxygen consumption is actually reoxidizing sort of old reduced compounds like iron sulfide. It suggests that the sediments have a memory and that oxygen consumption is sort of, there's some hysteresis or it's prolonged over the course of the year. It doesn't just correspond to the arrival and breakdown of organic matter. Now, slide. It's been a great challenge to try to understand what is controlling the rates of these fluxes across the sound. And this, although I recognize it's a complicated diagram for 9:30 in the morning, it's at least one way to sort of show the big picture of how the fluxes that we measured are related to environmental parameters we measure, like water depth and salinity and grain size and organic matter content of the sediment. In this diagram, which is a redundancy analysis, essentially a constraint, principal components analysis, where the axes have been constrained by our environmental variables. The vectors that are dotted represent the fluxes that we measured, and the vectors that are solid represent the environmental parameters we measured at each station. And the symbols represent where our stations fall out in this sort of multidimensional flux space. The way to interpret this diagram is that if you imagine these dotted vectors to be axes of a plot, you can project the stations onto these axes to see where they fall out in terms of their fluxes. So for example, 4022 has a fairly high dissolved oxygen and ammonium flux, whereas station 29 has a much smaller dissolved oxygen flux. 4029 has a high dissolved organic carbon flux. The solid vectors are vectors that indicate the correlation, how well these environmental variables are correlated with our fluxes. Now, one of the best correlates with dissolved oxygen flux is water depth. The deeper the station, the lower the dissolved oxygen flux. That's why the vectors point in different directions. Interestingly, dissolved oxygen flux is correlated with hydrogen ion flux. Remember, I suggested that in the springtime, the reason that dissolved oxygen fluxes are greater than we would expect is that perhaps this represents the reoxidation of reduced compounds in the sediment. Well, when you reoxidize, say, sulfide, you produce protons. Reoxidation of these reduced compounds generally produces hydrogen ions. And so this correlation between the hydrogen ion flux and the dissolved oxygen flux is consistent with the idea that much of the oxygen consumption in the sediment is reoxidizing stored reduced compounds. In general, the water depth is probably the best correlate with dissolved oxygen, followed by bottom water dissolved oxygen concentration, which is positively correlated with the dissolved oxygen flux. In other words, where you have a lot of bottom water oxygen, you create a strong diffusive flux into the sediment. And so we have higher rates of dissolved oxygen consumption. And that generally happens in shallower water. Next slide. Now, all these numbers are sort of not particularly meaningful unless you can relate them to the rest of the system. So one way to think about the contribution of the sediment to the overlying water quality is to compare the rates of oxygen consumption and the rates of nitrogen removal to other processes that happen in the water column. And so in this table, the first column shows water column dissolved oxygen consumption rates. And we have data from the Whidbey Basin and South Sound from a report done by Jude Apple, who measured, collected bottles and did shipboard incubations and measured the respiration rate in those basins. This summer, my lab measured respiration rates in Hood Canal. This was in July rather than in April. So there may be some offset in those data, but surprisingly, despite all the work done on dissolved oxygen in the Hood Canal, I couldn't find any water column respiration rates anywhere in my literature review. So we had to go out and measure them. Also, interestingly, there were some data from the 1950s on oxygen consumption in the main basin, Barnes and Coleus. There were some data on Hood Canal, I have to admit, in the 70s, Christensen and I forgot the other author. But if anybody out there has water column respiration rates in the main basin of Puget Sound, I would love to get a hold of them so that I can complete this comparison. But what I've done is we've taken the water column respiration rates and compared them to the benthic water column consumption from our benthic flux measurements. And we divide that benthic flux by the depth of the water column between the sediment surface and the picnic line to estimate what how much the bottom water oxygen or the sediment oxygen flux would change the concentration of oxygen in the overlying water. And if you compare these numbers, about 10% of the oxygen consumption in the Whidbey Basin is from the sediments, about 20% in the South Sound and Hood Canal are due to sediment processes. The main reason for the higher rates of, or the higher fraction of oxygen removal in the South Sound is because it's relatively shallow. We had relatively high rates of oxygen consumption by the sediment and low rates of water column respiration in Hood Canal. I don't really know the fraction of oxygen in the main basin removed by the sediment because we don't have good water column respiration rates. But if I just take the average rates of respiration for the other basins, I estimate that about 7.5% of the oxygen in the water column is removed by the sediment. And this is low in the main basin, largely because it's so deep. The sediments have less of a role. But what about nitrogen? This is a table indicating, slide please. I forgot. Here we go. Here I've plotted the fraction of dissolved inorganic nitrogen supply removed by denitrification. And this was done by taking the average inorganic nitrogen concentration in the bottom water and dividing that by the residence time of water in each basin. This is an estimate of how much nitrogen is supplied to these basins and compare that to the rate of denitrification. And in the main basin, the percent of dissolved inorganic nitrogen removed by denitrification is small, mainly because it has a fairly short residence time and is very deep. Same with the Whidbey Basin. Hood Canal has the largest effect of denitrification, mainly because the bottom water residence time is long enough that there's plenty of time for denitrification in the sediments to remove a significant fraction of nitrogen from the water column. The column on the right shows the phosphorus storage in the sediments. And essentially, as we saw before, all of the phosphorus that hits the sediment appears to be stored. There's very little return of phosphate from these sediments into the overlying water. Slide. Finally, I've just begun to investigate the role of sediment burial. How much nitrogen is buried by sedimentation? I found so far no estimates in the literature of that quantity. However, I know there are plenty of lead to 10 profiles out there that give sediment accumulation rates, and some of those data probably have nitrogen concentrations as well. One source for these data was a report by Brandenberger and Eric Chrysilius et al., who measured sediment accumulation rates in a number of cores taken from Hood Canal and the main basin, along with trace metals to try to understand the history of hypoxia. They didn't report nitrogen accumulation rates, but you can estimate that from their data. Basically, you take the sediment accumulation, mass accumulation rate times the concentration of nitrogen in the bottom of the core to estimate in the long term how much nitrogen is being removed by sedimentation. The nitrogen barrier rate is measured on a very different time scale than our denitrification rates. However, and there are very few sediment cores that I've found so far that have all the data necessary. But surprisingly, the rates are very similar, suggesting that nitrogen burial and denitrification have similar impacts on the nitrogen supply, on nitrogen removal from the water column. And both need to be taken into consideration. All right, now I'd like to shift gears, slide, to a finer detailed study on these processes in Bellingham Bay. Bellingham Bay is a great estuary. It has one wastewater treatment plant, has one main source of fresh water, the Nooksack River. You can perform a hydrographic survey and using Knudsen's relationship, estimate the mean circulation rate. So it's just I found it a great place to study estuarine circulation processes. And in late June, we collected fluxes from 25 stations. We also performed a seasonal study at one of these stations. And I mentioned that over the past 15 years or so, we performed hydrographic surveys and monitored nutrients to estimate a nutrient budget for Bellingham Bay. Slide. This is a plot of our dissolved inorganic nitrogen flux from the sites across Bellingham Bay. There aren't very many sites in the northern bay because the Nooksack River Delta is so broad, it goes out more than a mile, that you can't really easily get a boat in there. If we look at the nitrogen, inorganic nitrogen fluxes, they tend to be higher on the eastern side of the basin, where the water column is shallower and where we're closer to Bellingham. The highest inorganic nitrogen fluxes were actually found right next to the wastewater treatment plant on the lower right side. Interestingly, in Bellingham Bay at this point in time, most of the fluxes are net fluxes are out of the sediment as opposed to into the sediment. And as you might expect, based on the plot, the inorganic nitrogen flux does correlate with water depth. Slide. Despite the fact that the average efflux, there was an average efflux of nitrogen out of the sediments, we calculated the denitrification rate using a similar method to what we did in the rest of Puget Sound, and we found pretty significant rates of denitrification. But look at how the denitrification rates are fairly well distributed across the bay, rather than having this strong effect, depth distribution like the inorganic nitrogen fluxes. And so something besides just depth or organic matter supply is affecting denitrification. We have this sort of more uniform distribution. And again, I'm still not sure exactly what is driving the spatial variation in denitrification. On average, Bellingham Bay had higher rates of denitrification than the rest of Puget Sound, comparing it to our spring survey of those 40 stations. Slide. If we examine the dissolved oxygen flux and the dissolved inorganic carbon flux in Bellingham Bay, and this is again in sort of early summer after the spring bloom, we see a pattern that is completely different than what we saw in the larger study of Puget Sound, the 40 stations throughout Puget Sound. In Bellingham Bay, this plot shows the uptake of dissolved oxygen on the vertical axis and the flux of dissolving carbon on the horizontal axis. And remember, previously, in the spring, early spring, we saw that the sediments throughout Puget Sound were consuming more oxygen than we expected. But in this case, the dissolved inorganic carbon flux was actually greater than the oxygen flux, suggesting that at this point in time, something other than organic matter breakdown is controlling the dissolved oxygen flux. And we hypothesize that when the organic matter first hits the sediment, anaerobic processes release dissolved inorganic carbon, produce these reduced compounds, which are stored in the sediment for a period of time before they're finally oxidized. And so in the springtime, this relationship suggests anaerobic respiration is occurring, which does not consume significant oxygen, and that it takes a while before these reduced byproducts are ultimately reoxidized. Slide. To better understand this relationship, we measured the dissolved organic carbon flux and the dissolved oxygen flux at one station over the course of the year. Let's begin in the summer. In the summer, we saw that the dissolved organic carbon flux was greater than the dissolved oxygen flux. The dissolved organic carbon flux is the blue column, the oxygen flux is the orange column. And this again suggests storage of sulfides and other reduced compounds. By the time we get to the fall and winter, the relationship turns around and the DIC flux, the oxygen flux becomes greater than the inorganic carbon flux all the way into spring, which is what we saw in our spring survey of stations throughout Puget Sound. So it suggests that, again, there's sort of this hysteresis or memory in oxygen flux, that the flux of oxygen is not simply a function of the organic matter mineralization rate, but that the oxygen consumption is spread out throughout the year as these reduced compounds are broken down. Slide. If we consider the impact of sediment processes on nitrogen cycle in Bellingham Bay, I can use the data collected by my environmental science class when we put together the budget for nitrogen in the bay and compare that to our denitrification rates. The table on top shows our nutrient budget that we collected last spring. It indicates, if you look at the right-hand column, that by and large, like almost 95% of the nitrogen supplied to Bellingham Bay is from deep water inflow. About 4% is from the Nooksack River, and less than 2% is from the wastewater treatment plant. This is typically what we find. Deep water always contributes more than 90% of the nitrogen, and the contribution of the Nooksack River varies based on its river flow. So it varies a bit, and the Post Point wastewater treatment plant is always small. If we consider the total rate of supply of nitrogen and compare that to the denitrification rate, we estimate that about 11% of nitrogen supplied to Bellingham Bay is lost due to denitrification. Slide. So these data give us an estimate of the rates at which the sediment are affecting dissolved oxygen and nitrogen. We can estimate the contribution of sediments to water quality. However, there are some serious gaps. Both of these studies were done at one point in time, and clearly there is seasonal variation in these processes. Furthermore, sediment cores show high variability, even among replicates. And if you think about it, these sediment cores are 8 centimeters in diameter. And we're drawing conclusions about, you know, the main basin of Puget Sound based on tiny sections of the sediment. It's apparent that sulfate reduction and sulfide oxidation strongly influence dissolved oxygen uptake. Hence, the sulfur cycle really needs to be studied. It's not clear to me what is driving the variation in denitrification. And finally, there are some estimates of burial of nitrogen, and it may be significant, but there aren't, as far as I can tell, at this point, I haven't found very many estimates of nitrogen burial. And given that the few estimates we have put it on par with denitrification, it indicates that more work needs to be done in that area. Now, slide. In order to address some of these uncertainties, I'm going to briefly describe in the last minute I have what work we've been doing recently. And these data are from this summer. In order to address the fact that core incubations take a tiny section of the sediment and apply that data to the large swaths of Puget Sound, this summer we tried a different method of estimating denitrification in Hood Canal. The profile of red dots indicates the nitrogen gas content of the water column. Nitrogen gas is the end product of denitrification, and the blue line indicates the nitrogen gas concentration you'd expect to see if it were saturated. The important thing to note is that there's more nitrogen gas at depth than you would expect. Now, when we first started this project, I was thinking that if I measured nitrogen gas along the length of bottom water in Hood Canal because of estuarine circulation, it would increase as you went along the bottom of Hood Canal. And it turns out circulation in Hood Canal is more complicated than we expected. But thanks to Parker MacCready and my colleague Sam Kastner, we got data from the LiveOcean model on vertical mixing rates. And if you multiply the gradient in vertical gradient in nitrogen gas by the vertical eddy diffusivity, you can estimate the denitrification rate for these two stations. This estimate, because it's in the water column, averages over a larger area of the bottom. And interestingly, we get numbers that fall right within the range that of denitrification rate estimates that we got from our core incubations. So two very different methods give us very similar results. Slide. So let's wrap this up with some take-home messages. Sediments consume up to 20% of the oxygen demand in some basins of Puget Sound. But there is this memory or hysteresis in the oxygen consumption. That is, oxygen consumption doesn't just correspond to organic matter supply to the sediment, but there's some other process that stretches out the oxygen consumption over the course of the year. Sulfate reduction and oxidation may be the key to understanding this. Denitrification and burial both remove a significant fraction of nitrogen, particularly in Hood Canal, which has a long residence time, and in Bellingham Bay, which is fairly shallow. However, there are still significant gaps in our understanding. Clearly, these processes are going to be varying seasonally, and our snapshots in one time, therefore, cannot possibly give an accurate estimate of the overall role of sediment, oxygen consumption, and nitrogen consumption. And furthermore, burial rates of nitrogen, I think, need to be studied in more detail. And we've started measuring those rates as well. So despite 50 years since Mario Pamatmat first studied these fluxes in Puget Sound, we still have a lot to learn. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, David. Lots of great content there, and looking forward to the questions and discussion here as well as in follow-up. There were a few in the chat, but folks can definitely raise hands and we'll get you unmuted. The first I'll ask, I think you touched on this a little bit with the work in Bellingham Bay in particular, but just anything you want to add about the variability kind of within embayments and how adding potentially additional monitoring sites may influence what we see there.
That's very interesting. There is variability on all spatial scales, from replicate samples that are taken within 7 meters of each other to variability among basins. So yes, in general, with high variability, more replicates will give us a better estimate of all these processes. More replicates would be costly, but indeed, that would be great. Sea Grant is on the line, I suspect. That would be great.
Awesome. Thank you, David. Parker, I see your hand up, so please go right ahead.
Sure. Hey, David, this was a great talk, like really great. I enjoyed it so much and I learned so much. I wonder if you could compare just, this is a methods question. The benthic flux measurements I'm more familiar with were made by Al Duvall, and he used these benthic flux chambers, sort of an in situ. And could you just tell me about the difference between how you're measuring benthic fluxes and how he's done it?
Yes.
Thanks.
Yes, good question. Al and I had worked together actually in the Bering Sea on these processes as well. And there we used our core incubations like we did, mainly because it wouldn't be possible to put a benthic flux chamber down on the bottom. When benthic flux chambers and core incubations had been compared, they generally compare fairly favorably. Both benthic chambers and core incubations have their pros and cons. The main thing about benthic flux chambers that are great is that the temperature and pressure are unchanged. In theory, there's less core disturbance because you're not collecting the sediment out of the bottom. And so in theory, they should give us a better estimate of these fluxes. However, you're still changing the flow, just like with core incubations. Al might actually be on the line, and I don't know if he is or not. He might actually have a better answer than me. But the advantage of the core incubations is you can get a lot more work done. You can do a cruise and just collect the sediments and get them incubating. The key to successful shipboard core incubation measurements is that you find a quiet place to do these incubations where the temperature is controlled and where there's minimal core disturbance. And in that case, the rates compare favorably based on the literature that's compared both methods. Thank you for the question.
Thanks, that was great.
Wonderful. I see a couple more questions in chat. One from Greg, is there a relationship between the magnitude of the measured fluxes and the stirring rates in ex situ incubations?
Good question. If the stirring rate is excessive, then yes. Studies show that you can sort of falsely elevate the rates. It's sort of art. Our stirring rates were about 1 revolution per second, which is enough to homogenize the overlying water without reducing significantly the diffusive sublayer of the sediment. Ultimately, I can't say definitively anything about this, right? Whether you put a benthic chamber down or you do a core incubation, you're doing your best to try to simulate the natural environment as much as possible. The key, I think, is just keeping your stirring rate slow, but ultimately, I'm making a statement of faith more than anything that it faithfully represents nature, although I can't say with certainty that it does.
Thank you, David. I appreciate just the transparency when it comes to all of this. The other question is from Rich, which is, how much do you think benthic respiration from sediment organisms plays a role? Could it help explain some of the differences between observed and expected DO consumption rates?
Thank you very much for that question. We examined that very question by looking at the correlation between benthic biomass and oxygen consumption rates. And we could not find any effects, any correlation. Nevertheless, there are plenty of examples where the respiration rate of particularly large benthic macrofauna can play a huge role in oxygen consumption. This tends to be particularly true in high latitude environments where perhaps the microbial oxygen consumption rate is dampened a bit because of the low temperature, but you can get a big clam in your sample or a brittle star that can consume most of the oxygen. So the answer to your question is, we're not able to gather the kind of data that would confirm that that's the case. There certainly, both macrofauna, myofauna, and microbes all are going to be consuming oxygen, but we did not see a correlation between benthic macrofaunal biomass and oxygen consumption rates.
Wonderful. Well, please continue to drop questions into the chat. I'm going to move us forward just so that we have some time for discussion.
Very much. And again, thanks, David. That was an incredible talk and so timely and interesting, and I learned so much. So I'll be talking today about the implementation of benthic fluxes in one model of the region called LiveOcean. And this is work done primarily by my colleague, Samantha Sidlecki at University of Connecticut. And so keep in mind that I'm a physical oceanographer and she's the chemical oceanographer. So I'll be giving a very garbled translation of this work. next slide, please. So the LiveOcean model is just a realistic simulation of this whole region. A lot of the coastal waters, all of Oregon, Washington, a lot of British Columbia, and the inland waters of the Salish Sea. It's forced to be as realistic as possible with atmospheric forcing, open ocean conditions, a lot of rivers, and of course tides. And then underneath it, it also has a biogeochemical model, an NPZD style model. In addition, it has oxygen and carbon variables. And this runs both as long hindcasts, but also as a daily forecast. And you can see those both on the daily forecast part on the NANUS NVS or also on the LiveOcean homepage. Next slide, please. So in terms of the benthic fluxes, the general design of the model is largely was designed based on getting stuff on in the coastal waters, right, especially the continental shelf, because that was what we were working on at the time this was designed. The specifics of the model are described in a paper by Samantha Sidlecki et al., and there's a slide at the end of this presentation that gives all the references here. It's a very short presentation, so I'm not going to go into a lot of detail. In general, the design philosophy is that the model is as simple as possible, but that still gets a defensibly reasonable answer and does it for the right reason. And the right reason means that the rates used in the model are constrained by observations. And so the model itself for the benthic fluxes can be described quite simply. There's of course, you create organic carbon particles from phytoplankton and zooplankton, and these sink at, the small particles sink at 8 meters a day, the large ones sink at 80 meters a day. And then generally the scheme is that there's what's called instantaneous remineralization. When the particles get to the bottom, they're remineralized back to DIN and they use up oxygen. In terms of one of these rate constraints, this the sinking speeds were constrained so that the oxygen respiration rates, the benthic oxygen respiration rates on the shelf and the slope were a reasonable match to observations. And I didn't show a slide of that, but it's in Sidlecki's paper. But this was for benthic fluxes of oxygen from about mid-shelf, so 100 meters, and then off to like 500 meters, so off on the slope, and showed that same pattern that David mentioned, that the oxygen, the benthic oxygen respiration rate gets smaller as you get deeper. Okay, let's see, there's also kind of the same players as David was mentioning. When organic matter rains on the bottom, it shows up back in the water column as ammonium, but it also causes a drawdown of nitrate from the water column, and this is so loss of nitrate, and it's again, this is something that's constrained by observations based on Aldeval's work with, and that's work with Clara Fuchsman on the shelf. to a constant rate in this case. So as again, as simple as possible, but with an observationally defensible rate. And then there's denitrification if the water, if the oxygen is very low. So next slide. The also consistent with what David showed, the water column remineralization is quite a bit greater than the benthic. So in this case, I'm showing the just for oxygen respiration water. And so you see in both case, in like the left two plots, the water column respiration, this just vertically integrated, is quite a bit greater than the sediment oxygen demand. Next slide. Then in terms of validation of the model, the as I said, the rates, we're not validating against the rates directly. They're like baked into the model, or they're used to inform the model itself. And then here's an example of oxygen time series on the shelf at about 70 meters depth on Hecate Bank, so off Oregon. And we've done a lot of this type of validation. And the results are similar throughout, whether you're in the Salish Sea or in on the shelf. And the bottom time series is the most important one because that's bottom oxygen from this mooring at 70 meters. The blue is the observations. You can see they didn't leave the mooring out in the winter. And we do a reasonable job, probably over-predicting low oxygen on the shelf is the sign of the error, but a reasonable correlation. So, and that was, this was actually produced by Jack Barth and Scott Dursky, who are the ones that collected the observations. And it's an interesting process. In this case, I made all the model output available to them and they did the validation work themselves, comparing the model to their observations, as opposed to me getting their observations. And that's an interesting cultural shift that I think is an important one to be able to do. Okay, next slide. Just thinking about differences between how this model works inside the on the shelf versus in the Salish Sea, I think this model is likely would want to be changed to work better inside the Salish Sea. And all the flux measurements that David mentioned are like going to be absolutely central to doing this. Just based on, you know, talking to people, of course, wave resuspension on the shelf is known to be extremely important and leads to very little net burial of organic matter on the shelf. It's possible that there's more burial of organic matter inside the Salish Sea because there's just less wave suspension, wave resuspension. But as David mentioned, not much data on this. So next slide. And these are all the references that I was including David's paper at the top on Bellingham Bay and his student Rigby, the next one. But that's it for my talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Parker. We're going to keep moving along with the modeling side of things. I'll turn this over to Stefano. And then after we wrap that piece, we'll come back for some Q&A on modeling kind of more broadly.
Thank you, Marielle, and thank you, Parker. So I will just do a brief overview and so some slides that we can use in discussion for the sediment module of the Salish Sea model. And we have, of course, Terang and Laura and others on this call that can discuss them further in discussion time. I'll also show the validation that has been done and some of the analysis and sensitivity, and then end on some proposed modeling analysis for Puget Sound Institute and some initial results there. Next slide, please. So the sediment diagenesis model in the Salish Sea model is based on De Toro's model in 2001. It's been applied widely, also integrated into the ICM model used in Chesapeake Bay, and in particular, the water quality analysis simulation program of the EPA WASP. And in fact, the Martin and Wool 2013 routines are then integrated into the FBCOM ICM by geochemical processes linking to the water column. Petier et al. 2017 really goes into detail on this, and it's covered in some of the others that I referred to here. So the implementation is a two-layer model. The first very thin aerobic layer in orange shown in the figure, and then a thicker sediment anaerobic layer with a total of 10 centimetres used throughout the sound in all locations in the grid. Next slide, please. And so at the start of every time step, we have settling and deposition of particulate organic matter from the water column. You can see the particulate organic matter at the top, and that goes directly to layer two of the sediments, where it's also split into the specific labile fractions, G1 to 3. And then the reactions that occur within dissolved form for both carbon and nitrogen occur in both layers that we've been discussing. The mineralized dissolved forms are then returned through the surface exchange back up to the water column, mainly as ammonium for the main form of DIN, dissolved inorganic nitrogen. And there's also a release of methane gas and nitrogen gas. And there's a loss to the system through burial and sedimentation below layer two at each time step. Next slide, please. So in summary, for the sensitivity work that's been done, this has been more recently on settling rates, nitrification and mineralization. For example, the settling rate on the first row here, looking at a difference between 5 meters and 10 meters a day for the labile and refractory portions of that particulate. It's also important to identify that the earlier work of Bernucci and colleagues also undertook sensitive analysis, particularly looking at dissolved inorganic carbon loadings and for both the freshwater and ocean boundary, which is important for the discussion here. And some further sensitivity analysis has been done on other related parameters, aeration coefficients, irradiance, and particulate organic matter. But in almost all cases, it's been maintained and it follows the parameterization in Kangonka 2018. Next slide, please. So the validation, the main data set that was validated is the same from Rich's group at USGS, which is a compilation across 25 sites in the sound, mainly flux chambers. And this is in detail in Pelletier 2017. Here we're showing the 23 measurements of those that are comparable, which was found to have a root mean square error of 0.73 grams. And that's comparing in this case and across ammonium and nitrate as well, the mean for the model for the year to those specific timeframes. So as you can see, if you read through some of the mean values for the annual flux, there's a overestimation compared to most, and this is to a late summer autumn calculation. And so this gives us the opportunity to explore a little further with the comparative model at the same time periods. But the same was done using that USGS compilation for both ammonium and nitrate. And I've got the comparative slides here if we need them for discussion. Next slide, please. In the bounding scenarios report, which is AMED 2019, Ecology did further validation. And this used multiple years. And so on the left-hand side, you can see the mean modeled output of dissolved oxygen for 2014, 2008, 2006. And it was reported that there was a very little difference between the two overall. That's a peak difference of 0.4 milligrams. Furthermore, using David's student's work, which was a Merit 2017 that he'd presented earlier, they looked at three cells shown on the right-hand side here, and this was the first direct temporal analysis comparing the time periods of June rather than just the annual comparison. And they found ranges, as you can see, between minus 13 to 30% difference on those three sites. Next slide, please. So we're looking at three steps for further modeling analysis and comparison to measured data with Puget Sound Institute. The first is to provide an expanded data set for model development and undertake further validation. We hope that will be useful also for the efforts that were discussed with Parker earlier. And also some folks here on the call from Susan Allen's group who are currently developing the Sediment Exchange as well. There is an intention to have a comparative model examination across at least those three models, and so perhaps this data set confirm the basis of that going forward. Second here is to examine the model output specifically. With a little bit more detail on this, on the sediment flux response to different loadings. And then the third here is specific to spin up time and stability. Next slide, please. So on the further validation, as we said, it's making the expanded measured data set available, which is shown in this GIS on the right-hand side, and then doing further model validation of that with the Salish Sea Model outputs at these locations. So just to orient, on the right-hand side, the mast areas of the Salish Sea Model are shown in green. Those are where the model outputs are not used in calculation, but they're calculated there. And then the red cells are those that ecology has identified as impaired for the 2014 model year run. And this shows the importance of focusing on the embayments. So in purple, you can see the 25 flux chamber sites. These are the purple squares across different embayments, and they go from the 1980s onwards, and that's in Rich's USGS compilation. And he's on this call as well, if there's any further discussion on that. And the additional validation step here is to consider a direct monthly modeled output to monthly measurements that are available at those sites, extending the approach that was done in mid-2019 for Bellingham Bay to other inlets shown here. Next slide, please. The next step is to get into a little bit more detail. As David said, the challenge is really understanding the whole year. And so there is an opportunity across three sites, which are shown with the boxes for Bud Inlet, Dalbab Bay and Bellingham. And these are where, for the first two, Aldeval and others have at least monthly measurements. And then, of course, Dave Shull's group for Bellingham Bay has a monthly measurement at least for 1 year and further. And then the last step here is the springtime comparison across a number of sites. And that's the new opportunity using Rigby 2019 data sets. And these are shown with the little brown points on the map here. Not only does this provide nitrogen and dissolved oxygen as was previously available at the other sites, but also dissolved and particular forms of carbon and phosphate, as well as silicate measurements. And these are from the sampling regime of our colleagues at Ecology, as David had talked about. This data set is particularly relevant as its springtime comparison across many of the sites that include the embayments where we have these low DO that have been identified, and these are circled here. So it's got a fairly reasonable coverage, and it would provide a comparative background data set of fluxes during the non-growth decomposition period of summer and autumn. I will go over three sites circled here in particular, and those are Bellingham in the north, Sinclair in the main basin, and Case, with a little bit more detail on some of the preliminary results. Next slide, please. So the second part is that we can examine the model outputs in a little bit more detail. And here it's really looking at how the model behaves and if it's behaving as expected with various loadings across different seasons and depths at these locations. The comparison of loading can use the two scenarios that are available for 2014. And that's the existing conditions for 2014 and a comparison to the reference or pre-anthropogenic estimated loading scenarios. And this follows a method that's been done in Kangonkar's Terang's paper in 2018. Next slide, please. Lastly, the sediment exchange spin-up and stability analysis. This simply takes the initialization files for the existing and reference runs. Again, using the most recent version available and published in Ecology 2021. And it's run for a year, taking the relevant sediment flux outputs to initialize then the same year, the same 2014 model run again in the way that's been done prior, you know, what called a cold start, hot start process. The difference is here we save the outputs that are relevant to the sediments, repeat this 5 to 15 times that has been done in other locations with other models, such as in Chesapeake Bay, and it should give an idea of the stability or change over time. And it's expected this will build confidence in the current parameterization used or may provide information on improved initialization data set that could be considered in future. Next slide, please. Right, so now we can look at just comparing some of the preliminary results. First of all, looking at the Rigby measurement data set and model data location for 2014 at that same location. So at the top, we have the prior results of the annual modeled outputs to measured data for those time periods that were identified in Petia 2017 study earlier. What we see if we compare the model to model results in the second table, that we have fairly similar results in terms of the range in mean. When we've initially outputted this data, and in comparison of annual numbers for the same sites, and so this is the second table below looking at the model to observe for Rigby 2019, where the data was specific to April and May, we see higher overall modeled annual sediment oxygen demand than for those months of April and May measured. Considerably higher ammonium released to the water column in the model, and then nitrate that's relatively equal in model and measured, and it's shown negatively here with the flux to the sediment. And of course, this requires detailed comparison at particular sites. Next slide, please. And so here we've got a little bit excited about working some of this up, and so we did want to share it for discussion today, but bear with us with some drafty preliminary plots and tables. But what you can see here, what we're trying to just show is the range of sediment oxygen demand over the year that is modeled at those 40 locations that match Rigby 2019. And with the exception of those sites that are above 1.5 grams per meter squared, most of those follow a fairly standard sediment oxygen demand response and are fairly similar. If we look at those that are higher from the top, it's Case Inlet, Sinclair, then Sinclair again, and then Bud. Next slide, please. So similar in range to the prior studies from ecology, the model outputs, if we look at there was an annual mean of 1.24, so this seems to follow accordingly with these model outputs. We do see a definite seasonal shift of about 0.3 to 0.9 milligrams in winter and early spring, and this moves to about 0.5 to 1.2 milligrams for summer to late autumn, shown in the dash box on the right. And what we're showing here in the red solid box is the early springtime period, which is the comparative period for the data from David's group. Next slide, please. Okay, so last I'll just show a few slides on some of the data that's from Bellingham Bay, Sinclair and Case. And to orient, these are the same model outputs, but we have Case in green, Sinclair in the various browns, and then the grey blue is Bellingham. We have sediment, oxygen demand at the top, ammonium in the middle and nitrate at the bottom. So all three model output fluxes for Bellingham are fairly similar in the blue-grey to what we'd seen for the other locations, and that follows fairly well for both ammonium and nitrate as well. In all, we see a corresponding increase in summer ammonium release with sediment oxygen demand in the model, of which the deeper water cast site exhibited the, case exhibited the highest levels for all of the sites that were examined of the 40. And then it was also fairly high for Sinclair, shown in brown, and then the shallow water light green side of CAR. Next slide, please. So we're just working up some of the measured to model comparison now that my colleague Rachel Mueller on this call is working on. And what I wanted to include is some of the preliminary plots in case they're useful in discussion. Again, at the top to orient, we have the sediment oxygen demand. In the middle, we have ammonium, and then at the bottom, nitrate. And here we've split the data into three inlets from the left to the right, which is Bellingham, Sinclair, and Case. So we intend to statistically compare the monthly measured data to the April or May data that was measured for the same time period, and very interested to hear input on the approaches we should use here. But here we've just overlaid those data so you can have a look at them for each of the inlets. From the top, for sediment oxygen demand, the model appears to capture the annual low around the time period reasonably well, though it's overestimating at these perhaps more productive sites of Sinclair and Case. And similarly, for ammonium, the model values are higher than the measured, particularly during the steep predicted increase of the model in April and May. Nitrate, which has a narrower range of results in the model, has comparatively a wider spread of measured data also from those sites. And here we've just been showing one of the measured data sets for one of the locations in each of those three. And next slide, please. With that, I will conclude and leave it open for question time.
Thank you, Stefano, and thank you, Parker. So please go ahead and drop questions into the chat. And then while you're doing that, I'm going to pull up some of the discussion questions that we're excited to brainstorm with you all around as we're trying to answer this broader question around when and where sediment has an important impact on nitrogen cycling and low dissolved oxygen impacts. And so it's part of getting some free flowing conversation, I am going to go ahead and give you all the power to unmute directly, to turn on videos, but would just ask that folks raise their hands so we're not talking over each other. But in the meantime, I'm seeing that Jeremy Testa, who is actually one of our model evaluation group members, who very kindly joined today because he's been iterating with us on this, did have a question for you, David, in the chat that can be discussed there. So just want to bring your attention to that. In the meantime, questions or reflections on the modeling front? And Stefano, do you want to kind of tee up this first discussion question while folks are thinking?
Sure. While folks, I think it's really great to be able to have this group together today. And it really comes back to these questions of really trying to, what was addressed in the marine water quality implementation strategy of how satisfied are we with our current state of knowledge on sediment exchange, particularly as we're getting more detailed on the terminal inlets? And that is across both the modeling front and its use of the model and the uncertainties associated, as well as monitoring and what kind of monitoring and modeling efforts should be considered in the longer term as well to constrain these.
Thank you, Stefano. We'll go Parker and then Mark.
Hi, this is more of a comment than a question. Just I'm struck in especially the results presented by David Shull, that the water column respiration is like, 80 to 90% of the total respiration that happens and the rest is benthic. And it seems like if you're trying to get, the benthic respiration right, the amount of organic matter that gets to the benthos is critically important. And if you're not getting that right, you're not, no amount of clever modeling of the benthic processes is going to get you closer to the observations. So it's really just, all the things that came beforehand are like, clearly like, 8 or 9 times more important than the benthos itself. And so, David, maybe you could comment more about what's needed for the water column remineralization and generally, particle fluxes constraint from observations.
Go for it, David.
I think that there's a surprising dearth of measurements of water column respiration in Puget Sound. It's such a fundamentally important process, and I have been shocked at how little data there are. Jude Apple has published a report, at least from the Whidbey Basin and South Sound and Admiralty Inlet, where some of that gap is addressed, but it's still for the main basin. I would love it if anybody knew of respiration rates for the main basin, because I haven't found them.
David, can you just outline for those of us who don't know much about it, how you make such a measurement
observation? Yes.
You showed an N2 method, but what about beyond that?
Yes, thank you, Parker. The basic way of measuring water column respiration is just to take water samples, put them in BOD bottles, and measure how water column oxygen drops over time. Do that from several depths and integrate. That's been the basic method for a century. different ways of measuring the oxygen have arrived, of course. Regarding the transport of particulate organic carbon from the water column to the sediment, that's a much trickier measurement to make. Either sediment traps or you could use tracers like thorium-234 to get particle scavenging rates plus some sediment trap data that gives you the carbon to thorium ratio. But those numbers would be great too, but that would be a significantly higher effort but I think a good one. Thank you for asking. I hope that answers your question.
Wonderful. And certainly we'll reiterate that called crowdsourcing from this group in terms of knowledge. If anybody has or knows of or even suspects there may be some of that data that David's talking about in the main basin, please feel free to drop it in the chat, or wants to collaborate on that moving forward. That's also part of these conversations as well. Mark, you are up next, and then we'll go to Amber.
So I have a couple of questions. The first one's for Stefano. Can you go back to your last slide with annual? Could you, maybe I missed it, but there's these very different consumption rates over time. And this is nitrate that you see. Actually, my question's answered. Can we go back one more slide? Where you were overlaying all the different profiles. Yeah, this one. What's happening at the very bottom? You have one profile where these are oxygen consumption or oxygen fluxes almost zero during a time of year where they're peaking almost everywhere else. Is this an anoxic or hypoxic basin?
Thanks, Mark. These are fresh off the press, and so I just looked at the top ones for now to discuss. So we can go and have a look, and I can follow up also offline on that. But these are modeled outputs, and I guess the first step would just be able to identify where that location is. So we'll have to do that offline.
Be interesting to have a place that becomes anoxic seasonally or hypoxic for comparison. And my next question is for David. With respect to the incubations, of course, I was wondering to what extent is bioturbation influenced by these whole core incubations, especially processes such as bioirrigation or ventilation, which could result in strong increases in oxygen consumption as the animals are pumping oxygenated water into their burrows?
That's an excellent question. I think the effect of bioirrigation is huge. One evidence of that is that if we measure fluxes of these solutes while the boat is running, they're very small. The animals, I think, are frightened. And once we put them into an incubator and turn off the lights and let everything settle down, the rates take off. And so we use for our fluxes those changes that occur during the time period when the animals are happy. You can never tell for sure if the animals are happy. We take sediment cores that are deep enough to try to collect all the organisms. And some of the animals are going to be sliced into pieces by the core. But in general, we do our best to keep the animals as happy as possible, recognizing that bioturbation and bioirrigation have phenomenally large effects on these fluxes.
Thanks.
Great, we'll hand it over to Amber.
Hey, thanks very much. And thanks for the talks, it was really interesting. I recently implemented a model like the one that was described in my model of the Northeast Pacific. I found it improved the DIC, but not the O2 and not the NO3 very much, which was somewhat disappointing. And so I was wondering from David, I was intrigued that you said that the sulfate reduction, sulfate oxidation may play a strong role. And that's something that's not included in my model. And I was curious, and maybe I missed it, but if you could just expand on why that process in particular you think is important. And sort of part two is maybe more general for modelers or for anybody. How might we parameterize this process in our models without including the full sulfur cycle?
Well, thank you for the question. I think the main effect of this process of sulfate reduction and sulfide oxidation is that oxygen consumption would be sort of spread out over a longer time period. That instead of just corresponding to, instead of, for example, the organic matter hits and then everything happens instantaneously, particularly oxygen consumption, the organic matter is broken down
some of that organic matter is broken down or anaerobically, some of it is broken down anaerobically, and the oxygen consumption then occurs over an extended time period as those reduced byproducts of anaerobic respiration are slowly oxidized. So, some of them, like iron sulfide, may be stored in the sediment for a long time because they're particulate, and it requires bioturbation, which was mentioned earlier, to sort of mix those particles to the surface sediments where they can be reoxidized. And so to answer your first question, I think interestingly, if oxygen demand is sort of spread out over a longer time period, the time when hypoxia occurs, which is sort of late summer, early fall, it might be that the models might overestimate the oxygen consumption during those critical time periods if they don't account for this hysteresis in oxygen consumption. Regarding how to do it without including the sulfur cycle, I think that I would have to go to a very quiet place and think about that. I don't think I can answer your question on the spot.
It is totally fair. And you're certainly going to open it up if for Tarang or Parker, if either of you have kind of any initial reactions around that from the modeling perspective. Otherwise, certainly a question for all of us to continue to chew on.
Yeah, I'll just follow up and say that the model does actually have a delay in the release. So, but what happens is the oxygen or the organic matter hits the seafloor, some of it's buried, and then only a fraction of it is released instantaneously. So it's not, there is still a delay that I've added, but it doesn't account for perhaps these longer processes. Like, I guess your answer is interesting because you're sort of saying, well, there's these deeper elements, these deeper bits of organic matter that get remineralized later. But I was wondering, like, what time scale? You said they've been there longer. Like, how long? Like, what time scales are you talking about?
I think that there's a couple of different timescales that are important. One is this, the annual timescale, because it appears that there's this sort of seasonal cycle of production and oxidation of these other oxygen utilizing compounds. Then there's a longer timescale, in that ultimately the difference between, say, the dissolved organic carbon flux and the oxygen flux on longer time scales would be a function of how much of these reduced compounds are ultimately buried and preserved longer. So it sort of depends upon your question. I think for the purpose of modeling environmental response to sort of organic matter mineralization, the annual time cycle time frame is the most significant and important.
Love to see all these hands coming up. Steph, now go ahead.
Actually, this is perfect because I can see Tarang's hand is up as well as Laura. And I was going to ask if perhaps Tarang or Laura could comment on this particular point as well in the implementation of the Salish Sea model that's being discussed. You know, how well do we capture this hysteresis and what with the current structure and what considerations might be needed in future. So I will hand back to you and hope to hear from either or both.
Okay, I'll go first since I raised my hand first and then Laura can answer, right? So first of all, David, I'm really happy to see the data that you have collected. And I was somewhat relieved to see that the data that you collected is more or less, how do you say, the model response is somewhat similar to what your data is showing, that in shallower embayments, we have higher sediment oxygen demand, and in the deeper basins, we have a lower flux. And so your data is consistent with the way we set up the model. And what we did initially is that we used our professional judgment to try and set the settling rates so that we got the right amount of sediment oxygen demand. So when we initially did the calibration, we had those measurements that you mentioned in your slides, historic sediment oxygen chamber measurements by Duval and various other people. And we had them laid out, and then we ran the model iteratively as part of calibration process to make sure we are sort of in the ballpark. That is, in the basins where we had the highest consumption of DO in the lower sediments, we had a sediment oxygen demand that could maybe go from 2 grams per meter squared to up to 10. And then in most of the other places, we had a SOD level that went from 0 to 1. And that was just a professional judgment type of setting up of the model without any rigorous calibration. And like you found out, in some basins, sediment oxygens can amount to almost 20% of the oxygen consumption, but 80% comes from water column processes. So while we have the sediments implemented through sediment oxygen demand DTOROS model, we also focused on making sure we got all the other processes sort of balanced out so that it reproduced time series of dissolved oxygen in the surface as well as bottom layers. So Department of Ecology has been collecting dissolved oxygen data in these 26 stations, and it's a rich data set that just by looking at the data, you can tell what's happening and when it's happening, right? And so many of those changes in water column and in the surface happen based on how algae grow and when they die. And as they die during the year from spring when you collected the data till September, you have this organic matter settling through the water column that draws on the dissolved oxygen. And it's 80% of drop happens through that. And then you have sediments too, continuing to apply that 20% draw. So the Salish Sea model has been set up by sort of modeling art, professional judgment, but having SOD data like the one that you have collected and the data that Parker mentioned that could be collected in the future will help us to further make the model more, make it more robust and rely less on professional judgment and then reduce the uncertainty. That was just my comment. And then the sulfide, I believe the DTORO model has that capability. We haven't implemented it, but I'm going to let Laura answer that question because she's the one who implemented SOD in our model.
Thank you, Trang. Laura, over to you.
I'll unmute myself first. Well, I wasn't going to talk about specifically that because I don't remember many of those details because I haven't worked with the model for a couple of years now, but I do remember it's there and we could definitely look into it. although again, it's adding more complexity to the model, which we need to balance out with the amount of data. Although it sounds like Puget Sound, it's the dream scenario with all these amazing data sets that are coming up. And I just wanted to make a little point about Amber's comment for those simpler models that have either remineralization or instantaneous remineralization or a simple kind of lag into the remineralization in the sediment model. And I'm just wondering if these new data sets that David was talking about are allow us to run some, you know, some tuning, some sensitivity analysis to see how big of a, like what's that remineralization timeframe that we need to implement in order to match the observations to the model. So I'm not sure if that's going to be very helpful to you, Amber, because I don't know if we have those kind of measures on the shelf here in BC. But maybe there is a way of using the Salish Sea observations into the consider them somehow and see the time lags that they find and try to use those in your model to just try different remineralization rates and hopefully improve the match between model and observations. That was all.
Thank you. David or Stefano, reflections from either of you on that? If not, we'll move to Mark.
I have a few more questions for David, and this whole idea of the sulfur cycle being important interests me. And I was wondering, do you have any evidence that places where the disconnect between oxygen demand and mineralization rates is the greatest, that there's more reworking, so sediment mixing by fauna happening that's bringing metal sulfides up to the surface where oxygen is present? And the next question is also whether the use of microsensors could be perhaps useful to look at oxygen and hydrogen sulfide concentration gradients to see if they actually meet and whether there could be an efflux of hydrogen sulfide into the very top layer of sediment where oxygen is present or into the overlying water.
Excellent questions. We did address that question in a study that I did not present the results for. We measured rates of bioturbation at one station in Bellingham Bay. It's we only did one station because it is a significant amount of work to do this. We also estimated where the organic matter goes, how is it remineralized? What fraction of the organic matter that hits the bottom of Bellingham Bay is oxidized aerobically by iron and manganese reduction, by sulfate reduction, and so on, using a bunch of different techniques and some models. And the site that we chose actually had very low bioturbation rates, low rates of iron reduction, and fairly low rates of sulfate reduction, about 25%. Of the organic matter was remineralized by sulfate reduction at that location. And so for one data point where we had low rates of bioturbation, we had low rates of iron reduction and fairly low rates of sulfate reduction. It would be great if we had more than one location. But to return to your first question, yes, I think that more research identifying the relative importance of these different mechanisms of organic matter mineralization would be really helpful in teasing out these processes and quantifying how important sulfate reduction is. Regarding microsensors, I suspect that hydrogen sulfide concentrations probably don't ramp up until pretty deep in the sediment because there's a lot of iron in these sediments that binds the sulfide. So perhaps there's a lot of sulfate reduction occurring in these sediments even without large high concentrations of sulfide. So on the one hand, measurements of sulfide along with some of these other types of sulfide like iron sulfides would be helpful, but getting at the rates of sulfate reduction is probably the key to understanding the role of sulfate reduction in this system. But excellent question.
What about microbial community analysis and quantifying sulfate reducers and sulfide oxidizers?
Yes, I that is outside my field. I suspect, however, that everybody is there and that they turn on when the conditions are right. So my gut feeling is if we look for the bacteria, we would find them. but that doesn't tell us how fast they're operating.
But the abundances tell us something, the relative abundances, I would argue.
Yes.
Thanks.
We have about 5 minutes left. I'm not seeing hands at the moment. So I wanna cold call Jeremy and just see if there's anything in terms of how you all have addressed this in Chesapeake. Or just reflections as you're listening to this that you want to throw into the mix.
Hi. All right. Well, I was just, I've been reflecting and listening and learning. So it's been helpful. What to say? Well, you know, one thing that we did that, you know, could be helpful, but I don't think I'd recommend it is we ran, you know, a version of the model that's in the Salish Sea model that had the sulfur, you know, whatever, how they're represented, the sulfur dynamics. So we ran it in kind of a standalone mode. And so, you know, there's a couple advantages of doing that. You know, one, you can kind of inversely estimate what the net depositional fluxes to the sediments are, you know, because you can constrain the oxygen flux, the ammonium flux, you know, the nitrate flux. You know, we've also, you know, you can also kind of get a sense for, you know, how much of a sulfur pool is there and, you know, how big the sulfide fluxes from the sediment could be if the sediments turned anoxic. So, you know, doing an exercise like that might be an indirect way to get after some of these questions, because a lot of the data, like that David's group has collected, could be used to constrain that kind of analysis. You know, I guess it, and it also comes down to, I'm thinking about with the example and kind of the, maybe what I understand to be a model that doesn't have sulfur in it, but that's in the offshore region, you know, like we were seeing today, if, you know, the water gets pretty deep, 30, 40 meters and beyond, the contribution to, of SOD becomes pretty small. And so given that, killing yourself to try to get a little bit better with SOD is probably not really gonna help you get oxygen in your model better. And so I think that's a reasonable rationale to take in a deeper basin. Yeah, that's those are some of the things that have been going around in the back of my mind. Thanks.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Mariel, I might just add to that, Jeremy, the in reading through the literature, our colleagues at Ecology did do some earlier testing with the standalone. I think that probably the same one, the Excel version, the VBA code that was written by, I think, Wool as well. And so perhaps that is something that could fairly easily be played with again for these new specifics with a follow-on collaboration, if asked.
Yeah, it's possible. I mean, the advantage is, you know, it doesn't get to all the details that are out there, you know, like the microbial community or, you know, what the profiles look like with depth. But given the information that's there, it would be a way to maybe get an idea of some of these numbers without doing a whole bunch of new empirical measurements, which are probably needed at some point. It's just a matter of getting them funded and done, and that takes time.
Practicalities are definitely an important part of the conversation for sure. We've only got a few minutes left, so just gonna zoom back out and ask that folks continue to kind of noodle on this question about, you know, our, as we think about level of effort and confidence, you know, are we satisfied with our state of knowledge on sediment exchange and terminal embayment specifically? And if not, you know, what additional modeling and monitoring in addition to what we've shared today would folks like to see? And so open invitation for that to be a continuing conversation there. And as we wrap up, just do want to highlight that we will have our next workshop on phytoplankton and primary production on the 2nd. And this will be similar to this in terms of being a little bit more focused and looking at that interactive relationship between modeling and monitoring. Monitoring and modeling, words there. Stefano, any final thoughts you want to throw into the mix before we let others drop off? You're muted.
just want to say thank you, and particularly to Parker and David. It's been great to start to work with you with some of this first iterations of, you know, the new monitoring data and how that can be used in an iterative monitoring and modeling. And so thank you very much. Thank you, everybody, for the great attendance and discussion.